Go ahead. Make my day.
Well, I don't like the word graffiti because it doesn't accurately describe what we do. That word is placed on our art form by the media, and it doesn't describe just, you know, how much talent it takes to do what we do.
We started riding on trains because here we are living in the South Bronx, and it's all dilapidated, you know? We had nowhere else to paint, you know? Someone got the idea of let's put our names on that train, and it kind of became like a voice from us, a voice of the ghetto.
It's like a traveling canvas. It's like artists, great artists painted on canvases.
Yeah,
they wanted
canvases
to express their art. But we have a certain kind of canvas. We have a canvas that no matter what, it's gonna travel around, and people, I'll do my piece in the Bronx, and it'll travel through Manhattan, and people will see it in Manhattan. It'll travel through Brooklyn, and people see it in Brooklyn.
And it became like my newspaper, you know, and telling people, hey, man, here I am, you know? Kid in the South Bronx, man, living in hell. It was wrong at the time, but I got a good feeling out of doing that. You know, it made me forget about what's happening around me a lot of time.
New York City got transit, and that's the way that they get their thing around, and the only thing I've got is walls. When I first came to Heath Town, it was strange seeing a place like that, a place that was like built up and close, like a lot of walls and dark gray walls. Living in that kind of community, it's just another urban no-go. It was through the social conditions what I was living in, which inspired me to paint. In the earlier days, you know, it was kind of cat and mouse, you know what I mean, what I was doing. And slowly when the murals built up in Heath Town, like it got to about 60, 67 murals. And then things started getting hot, you know what I mean? And I kind of really confronted the police about painting because they would see me painting in an environment which was a closed community. The police have never really come down on me because I would be automatically be back out there and painting again because that's where I live.
Well, we have our own language, you know? We write to each other on moving trains. You know, we call each other, we have singles and stuff that nobody knows. Like, we're walking down into a tunnel, we'll go, ee-wee, and they'll know who it is just by that call, you know? Automatically, they know to get out the way because the best is coming through.
The public would look at our art, and they're like, half of them would like it because of the colors. We bring life to the trains. It's instead of a dull gray train, you're seeing colors there. It's like bringing, you know, new colors into your life, you know? There were some who would just put it down. They would condemn it without even looking at it, without even giving it a fair look. So that gave, you know, our art a bad name altogether. That's what gave it the name Graffiti. The first graffiti art writers, right, the first graffiti artists, they started with just writing their names, as you would write it, you know, with the pen on a paper, just your name. And what they would do is just fatten up the lettering, you know, a few times. That's how it all started. That was the first wave. The second wave, they started adding on more things to the fat lettering. They would add another color around it to, you know, like accent it. Then us is the third wave. Now we like add more dimension and depth to it.
Wow, stop.
Wildstyle was a gang, right? That they originated letters that are very wild, okay? And they started back in the late 60s, all right? So the term Wildstyle letters came, in fact, from the gang Wildstyle, and which is like also a way of life. That's how we live.
See, I titled this painting Smoky Dreams. Because if you see in the background, it's like a futuristic city. And in the forefront, you see like a abandoned building scene and with a broken window. And behind the building, there's like a robot hiding, and he's, you know, hiding to smoke a cigarette. More or less, like, you can have your own meaning to this.
I'm inspired by a lot of the New York writers, you know what I mean? And like, I stick to my own kind of different style. Me, I don't really write my name because I think my name's irrelevant over here. It don't mean nothing to nobody. I like to paint to like sci-fi kind of things because that's the kind of, I suppose that's just the style which I like to do.
lost in space. It's like, in a place like this, a lot of kids lost in space. They get to five, they see crime, and they, you know, that's all they've got to live for. And then they grow up, and then they have kids, and the kids stop here. And you see pregnant girls walking around, like young, you know, 16, 17. And, you know, they have kids, and that's the only thing they're gonna do. They're just being stereotyped to be in that kind of lifestyle.
I've been good and I've been mad. I've been guilty of hanging around.
So really it has two meanings. On the artistic side, being able to do something which I want to do, and on the social side, being able to write a comment that the public will understand.
Most spray paint artists aren't formally trained. They don't have any formal training. Some do, some don't. But I think in an art form this new, there is no right and wrong, and the innovators in it are the ones that, you know, make up the rules and set the trends and develop techniques. And I think that's a good thing. You know, you don't have anybody telling you what to do. I mean, because there were artists before there were art schools.
Let me tell you something. Most of us, like me, I never went to art school.
Nobody has gone to,
you
know, art school.
I never had to deal with no arts, yeah, or anything like that. My art was when I woke up in the morning, I walked down the street and I looked around me, that was art. You know, seeing a wino laying on the street, you know, hang over from the night before, blood on the street over there somewhere for something that happened the night before, you know? All this, you lay in bed at night sleeping, you know? And you start hearing these things, and you get all these ideas in your head.
There's rarely a chance you ever get to see anybody painting, because it's illegal. So, like, they get different images of you. Like, you'll meet somebody, and they'll tell you, your bio, wow, I had a whole different picture of you. Oh, I thought you was white, or I thought you was black. I thought you were bigger because of your paintings. You always like do big, colorful stuff. I thought you were a giant. You're not so big.
Survivors is like directly attacking, you know, like nuclear war, like nuclear holocaust. You know, he's looking for survivors and he's like the only man left. And he's not even a man, he's like half a man. Future world machines is like the whole scene, really, the whole thing, like with machines taking over, like, you know, man getting something to replace himself. Saying, you know, machines can't exist, but, you know, there's machines to plow a field and there's machines to kill man.
This is a famous photo of Marilyn Monroe. Everyone's seen that, you know, like the dress being pulled up with the wind. But what I'm doing here is like making the aerosol spray can, like sort of like lifting her dress. So it's like my own little funky fantasy.
You do all kind of like throw offs of different things, and that's what makes the art develop through doing different things. Like, you know, they can't turn around and say that that's graffiti.
I'm not sure everybody can walk off the street and do this. Just walk in, pick up a can, and do something like this. That's why, you know, I feel we should get the respect as artists.
You could like it, you could hate it, but I'd like to just be considered an artist, and I'd like to be able to have people look at my work. I'd like to be considered a fine artist, and spray paint to be considered just the medium I use. I just like it to be viewed, period.